Hello, I'm Alison Watry, director of the UC San Diego Stem Cell Program. And this is the Sanford Stem Cell Clinical Center. So why do I have these little guys here with me? One of the future hopes for treating leukemia is using the cells that give rise to blood, hematopoietic stem cells. And these guys have helped us to understand a lot about how the cells do that. The Sanford Stem Cell Clinical Center is one part of the UC San Diego CIRM Alpha Stem Cell Clinic. The CIRM-funded Alpha Stem Cell Clinics are a network of top California medical centers like the UC San Diego Health that specialize in bringing the latest stem cell clinical trials to patients to treat many afflictions, among them blood disorders like leukemia. UC San Diego's David Traver uses these zebrafish and other model organisms to understand exactly how these very special blood stem cells are born, with the goal of duplicating that process to cure diseases. It is the goal of CIRM that discoveries made by people like David will someday cure blood diseases at clinics like the Sanford Stem Cell Clinical Center. David shared why and how the zebrafish has helped us and what they have revealed that is leading us toward cures.
We study the stem cells that make blood, which are these very rare stem cells in our bone marrow. Despite their rareness, they have really impressive proliferative power. They can generate all of the hematopoietic lineages we have for our entire life. So the thought in the field is that leukemia, and probably all cancers in general, occurred due to mutations within these stem cells. Any one of those lineages can be transformed to give rise to leukemia. You can have T-cell leukemia, B-cell leukemia, there are granulocytic leukemias, myeloid leukemias, lymphoid leukemias. There's as many types of leukemias as there are lineages. So the gold standard treatment for leukemia is bone marrow transplantation, really the first stem cell treatments in the clinic. This has been around since the late 1950s. When it works great. If you have an identical twin, for example, then bone marrow transplantation can work exceptionally well. But most people don't have that, right? So in that case, you can get all sorts of immune rejection. So that's why the field has been looking for a long time to try to make patient-specific hematopoietic stem cells. It was sort of a pipe dream for a long time, but in the last 10 years, it really has become reality because of Shinya Yamanaka's findings that you can take essentially a handful of factors, put those into basically any adult cell type, and transdifferentiate that cell to something that is pluripotent. And that cell that you can essentially just make from a swab from the cells in your cheek, they'll become the so-called induced pluripotent cells, or iPS cells, and those cells then have the potential to make any cell type in your body. So that part is actually very straightforward. We could make iPS cells from you or me in a matter of weeks. That part is very trivial now. The challenge for the field is then to recapitulate development. So you can't transplant iPS cells by themselves because they're too naive, they're too immature, they don't know who they're supposed to be. So what you need to do is then take these cells in vitro and instruct them to become certain types of cells. There are liver stem cells, hematopoietic stem cells, neural stem cells, and those are the cells you'd want to transplant into somebody, right? Because to keep a patient alive for years, you have to have stem cells being transplanted. And so people have been trying to take these pluripotent cells and instruct them to make hematopoietic stem cells for 30 or 40 years now, and we just haven't been able to do it yet. I think the main reason for that is because we just don't understand how the embryo does it, right? We don't know the full recipe. And so the major goal of my group is to try to use lessons from the embryo, mostly the zebrafish embryo, because it presents these really nice opportunities to do imaging. Another reason that developmental biologists love the zebrafish is because they develop extremely quickly. The hematopoietic stem cells, for example, in humans take months to develop. During zebrafish development, we think these initial specification events are happening about 12 to 14 hours after fertilization. You can actually watch these things happen sort of in vivo, in real time, using confocal imaging and time-lapse imaging. We actually had the first demonstration of how exactly hematopoietic stem cells are born because we simply just imaged these embryos. We can actually watch the process of hematopoietic stem cell formation, and we saw that these hematopoietic stem cells actually derive from the floor of the dorsal aorta. The dorsal aorta is the biggest blood vessel during development, and interestingly, there's just a population of these endothelial cells that line the dorsal aorta that then transform in this very interesting process to hematopoietic stem cells. And so what you can see in this movie is that you see these endothelial cells that are forming the floor of the dorsal aorta. They'll change their shape. You'll see the cells become a round cell. Over the next few hours, you can see that cell then lose its contact with the endothelium and actually enter circulation going in through the roof of the vein. Those hematopoietic stem cells will then go to the specialized structure in the tail where they'll start to differentiate and make adult blood cell types. This is true not only in a zebrafish, but it's true in a mouse, it's true in people. So no matter what kind of vertebrate animal you are, your hematopoietic stem cells come from the endothelial lining of your dorsal aorta. And so once we saw that, we then knew, okay, this is the event we need to study. This is the event we need to understand, because this is the first time we've actually been able to see the birth of a stem cell. And so what we've been trying to do since then is essentially roll the movie even further backwards to understand where those cells come from, right? And when do those cells know they're going to be that cell? So one of our goals in the lab is to know what factors are needed to make a stem cell, what order those factors are produced in, the relationships between those genetic hierarchies. We've made some surprising discoveries. During development, these cells make direct contact with the bottom of a structure called the somite. Somites are these big chunks of tissue that are along the entire developing embryo. They later give rise to skeletal muscle, all of your vertebrae. The cells that are fated to go on to become the hematopoietic stem cells, they crawl and make direct contact with that sort of bottom face of the somite. If we can understand what the somite is doing, we can essentially just short-circuit the process, take the factors we know that are key and add them to the cultures at the right time. Try to push those cells to become the right lineage, basically. In this way, we've also discovered some other surprising things. In the adult, if you get a wound, you make things like a tumor necrosis factor called TNF. In the embryo, we found just sort of serendipitously that you also need this pro-inflammatory factor to help generate hematopoietic stem cells. So we just have to understand what factors are needed, the order in which they're needed, then we can try to, you know, essentially distill those factors to add to these culture systems to try to push those cells to the right place. And so the 10-year goal, basically, is to be able to make patient-specific stem cells. If you have leukemia, we want to be able to irradiate you or treat you to wipe out the leukemia, also wipes out your normal blood-forming system. So the idea is we would take the cell from your cheek, transduce it with these factors, in a period of a couple of weeks, we can make your iPS cells. We can then take those iPS cells and generate your own hematopoietic stem cells that can then be put back into you. Make all again of those hematopoietic lineages you need and stick around for the rest of your life. So that's the goal. Patient-specific stem cell transplants.
Bringing cures from labs like David's to a clinic like this is a challenging journey. I sat with Katrina Jamison, who heads the UC San Diego CIRM Alpha Stem Cell Clinic, and share insights into what the present and the future of hematopoietic stem cell therapies are and how the Alpha clinics are making that happen. What are the most exciting things that's coming out from this field?
Well, I think because of major advances in stem cell research that actually evolved from labs where people worked on these model systems, be it mice or zebrafish, we started to understand how stem cells really work and then expanded that to human blood-forming stem cells. And I think what's really exciting now are things that took 20 years to get to the clinic, like stem cell gene therapy for severe combined immunodeficiency. Now we say, of course you can do that, and within the Alpha Clinic network. So the Alpha Clinics were called Alphas in the first letter of the Greek alphabet because they're the first. Mm-hmm. It was a grandiose suggestion that we should have one-stop shopping for patients who have degenerative diseases that could benefit from stem cell therapies. And so it has expanded where we were one of the first three sites to include not just UCLA and UC Irvine, not just UC San Diego and City of Hope, but UCSF, UC Davis. You know, we're a catchment area of 20 million people. And we're trying to bring stem cell therapies closer to home. So the most exciting thing to me is that we can do that as a network, that we can share clinical trial protocols. We can share confidentiality agreements and contracting. That may not sound very exciting to people that are saying, but what about the science? This makes the science possible in the clinic faster. So it means we can get up and running very quickly. And when you think about technologies that are curative, like stem cell transplants for severe combined immunodeficiency, which they are, making these kind of really involved therapies more accessible to patients is our whole raison d'etre. Mm-hmm. So whether it's for chronic granulomatous disease or Stephanie Cherqui's work with inborn errors of metabolism, I think we can do that for these rare diseases. But I think what that tells us is we can do that for more common diseases. And we can really start making inroads on spinal cord injury, type 1 diabetes. Those are the trials we're doing. So when we started our trials, we did a phase 1 trial, first in human, to target leukemia stem cells and chronic lymphocytic leukemia with an antibody we made with CIRM funding. Mm-hmm. So we called it CIRM-tuzumab. So we started that September 2014. We started a spinal cord injury trial with neural stem cells, September 2014. And we started a type 1 diabetes stem cell trial, also September 2014. We thought everybody did that first in human, mm-hmm. you know, three trials in 1 month. And so we just thought it was possible. And it's, you know, that's what's really exciting, that you can get those technologies. In terms of hematopoietic stem cell changes, we've talked about CRISPR. So, you know, a number of our labs have worked on trying to edit DNA. And I think what's really exciting, as you know, is I'm very excited about editing or repairing RNA. Mm-hmm. So DNA you can change or try and correct when the cell is dividing, but a lot of the changes happen in cells that aren't dividing, and they've changed their RNA more than their DNA. So what I mean by that is if you try and remodel your house like we're trying to do now, the DNA is like the architect's blueprints. The RNA is the engineer's interpretation of that blueprint, because often when you look at the architect's blueprint, it's completely different. The engineer said, no, there has to be a retaining wall. There has to be something to hold up that building. And then the protein is like the builder. So you have these three levels. And what happens in a lot of blood-related diseases is you have problems at all three levels, DNA, RNA, and protein. And what we found in various blood cancers is you activate an enzyme that really affects the RNA called ADAR, A-D-A-R-1, so ADAR is on our radar. But more than that, people have been very, very clever to say, there's an RNA editing enzyme that went awry in cancer. Let's see if we can make it behave as an RNA repair mechanism in cells that are no longer dividing, post-mitotic Correct. Cells. Mm-hmm. So I think that's extremely exciting. And that's a basic stem cell technique. It's by understanding stem cells and how they clone themselves or self-renew that we started looking into things that can be repair strategies. So sometimes by investing in technology, you see something completely different than anything you'd ever thought you could use in an advantageous way. Mm-hmm. So I think that's really what's happened now that we're racing into clinic. There are things that we can do that are even more clever because of this sense of a collective responsibility for getting stem cell therapies to the clinic.
And you guys are putting yourselves on the spot, right? I mean, by doing that.
Thanks for putting that out.
But is it the hope that other parts in US, perhaps in the world, will actually reproduce that model?
You know, that is certainly my hope, and certainly my entire drive to say I hope that this can be reproduced in other places. There's something unique to this environment mm-hmm. that's hard to transplant into other places. And it's not because they can't, it's because they don't think they can. Mm-hmm. And so giving that sense of ridiculous enthusiasm that we have, and the sort of casual thing where we can have these discussions and say, what do you think? Is this a crazy idea? And then you'll say, yes, it's a crazy idea, but I have this reagent that you can use. So you can test it. So we'll have these discussions and they seem casual, but that's how you get really important scientific ideas to the clinic. Mm-hmm. That's what abbreviates the timeline. So if you talk to people, they say, oh, it takes 15 years to translate discoveries to the clinic. That's because it's like, did you watch the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
So imagine if you changed the quarterback at halftime.
Right. Yeah.
And then imagine if you changed the stadium as well. You would really mess up the game. And that's what happens in therapeutic development all the time. They change the team, they change the whole goal, and so people lose track of what was going on and they drop the ball. Mm-hmm. By having integrated teams where we have the Sanford Consortium for Regenerative Medicine, we make basic science discoveries here, we have sufficient funding to be able to translate those discoveries, de-risk those discoveries by doing a lot of the initial translational work ourselves, which usually is thrown to a team that doesn't know anything about it in industry, and then get it to the clinic for the phase one with, you know, interaction with the original team, the original investigators, then we don't drop the ball and not know what was going on in the lab. Mm-hmm. Because it's still very scientific in the clinic when we get into a phase one trial. Usually you can look at safety and tolerability, but not proof of concept. We still have to show that the mechanism is relevant for that disease.
Right.
And so by maintaining that continuity of communication, we're able to make sure that we stay focused and that we don't spend a lot of time spinning our wheels when really we could have done a better design clinical trial. We're at a phase right now when you look at stem cell research in terms of the basic, the translational, and the clinical aspects, where we're going to do reverse translation, where we're going to understand from looking at people in the clinic where we didn't quite get it right and say, wait a minute, we've got to make something better for you.
That's a good point.
So it's going to be more bespoke. Let's make this more precise and let's see what can we do for you that is very specific to your disease, where it may be a different variant of a Cardi-Gutierrez syndrome or whatever it is, but something where we can combine genomics with stem cell research so we do precision regenerative medicine, and we can do that in a continuous way. So when I see people in clinic, they say, oh, you know, you've dealt with my bone marrow disorder, but, you know, I've got this terrible disc disease. Can you help to repair my degenerative disc disease? So we can work on one-stop shopping. So not only the actual specific disease that people came to us for, but what else is going on in your life, you know, your overall health, so we can start to improve these other aspects because they all act on each other.
Thanks so much, Kat. I think this was very insightful, and I hope we can do this one more time again in the future.
I hope at least once, Allison.
Yeah.